coming to the Jedi panel. How's everyone doing today? Good, good. Let's give it up for Jesse and Nalini for coming. Okay, so let's start where it all began. So can you guys just give us like your backgrounds a little bit, and how did you get amazing roles as Jedi in Star Wars Attack of the Clones?
I'll start because my story's not as exciting as yours. it was really easy, actually, very simple. My agent called me and they said, they would like to see you. They would like you to come in. And I thought, what do you mean they would like me to come in? I thought, oh, okay. Maybe they're just, you know, wanting to just audition me. So I went to Fox Studios in Australia, in Sydney. And next thing you know, they were fitting me out for the costume. So obviously I got the part. I didn't even know what I was, who I was. And that's literally how I got the role. So no auditions or anything. I just looked the part, I guess.
Yeah. And so, yeah. Based on the fitting of the costume and stuff, how does that actually work? Did they just come in and just take your measurements and anything? Did you have any idea what your costume was going to look like?
Yeah, they had pictures and drawings of Barriss Offee and her costumes. They were very detailed pictures. And they literally just measured me up for the whole costume. But it was already laid out, what she was going to look like, what skin color, you know, what belt, all of it. Was already drawn out. They'd already had that in place. It was just a matter of measuring me up and making it tailored.
You did two or three fittings, I suppose?
I think I did a couple of fittings. Yeah, I went back a couple of times. So they did the initial fitting, then you go in and you try the outfit on, and they make some alterations, and then they have it finalized for the shooting.
How long did it take between your measurements and then getting the costume actually right? Was it
I think it was literally within the week or so. I don't think it was long at all. And they were pretty organized actually on the set.
Yeah. The Jedi tailors are pretty good.
Yeah, I'm sure. Okay. All right, and Jesse, how did you get?
My story is a little funnier, I suppose. I'll just go back a little bit. My younger brother, Zach, plays Kit Fisto. I think most people realize that. And he came down to visit me in Sydney, where I was working as well as a set carpenter on other movies. And he came down to visit me because I talked him into coming down. You have to get a job in Sydney, blah, blah, blah. And so I got him a job on Star Wars as a startup carpenter because he hadn't done sets before. So he got to build the benches and shelves and all the props for all the different wardrobes, props department. And the prosthetics people. And he's loving it. And he came home one night from work and goes, I'm going to be a Jedi. And I'm like, what? I was tired. I'm like, okay. He's like, no, I am. I was talking to prosthetics people and they have this mask that's going to fit me perfectly, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, great. I've been in this industry for 2 years or so. And then here he comes in the first, second week, he's a Jedi. Oh, okay. You're happy for your brother, right?
And then, is so unfair.
And it was Saesee Tiin that he was going to play. And then I end up starting on Star Wars as well, and I started building the Solar Sailor, which is the spaceship that's like that mm-hmm. Count Dooku had the fight with Yoda on. And so I was doing that for 3 months just in this workshop. It was a life-size spaceship, size of a bus. And so it was hot and sweaty, and Zach's having fun being a Jedi and everything else. And then he comes home another night because he's sleeping on my couch or something, and he's like, I'm going to be two Jedis. I'm going to be two Jedis. George Lucas talked to me and he loves my dreadlocks and he wants me to be this cool Jedi he's designed. And I'm like, oh, okay, that's cool, that's awesome. And so he had his own custom Jedi because with these green tentacles that matched his blonde dreadlocks at the time. And then he came running into the workshop about a week later and I'm there working away. He goes, quick, come. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I walked up there and I go, and he's telling me on the way, he's like, okay, both my Jedi's are in the same scene, they need a new one, and I told him that I've got a perfect guy for it, and blah, blah, and he said, yeah, that's how I got it. So I went up, they said, oh yeah, cool, if the mask fits, it's yours, it fitted, wow. And here I am. That's the story. So he was a good little brother in the end, looking after me, and giving me a Jedi part.
Probably made up for all those times he maybe irritated you when you guys were...
Oh yeah, well, still, I suppose. Well, and now he still works with me, actually, so we work together on Survivor, that's my day job.
Does he ever remind you, oh, do you remember that time that I totally made you a Jedi?
Not really, because I could probably get a long list I could pull out. You remember the time that I made your money, I got your car, I got your job, you work on, we're pretty even.
So that ship that you built for the Count Dooku scene or whatever, can you tell us about that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
So, it was a Solar Sailor. It was one of the full-size props, because a lot of the ships, they make models and they just shoot them small and you kind of think it's a full-size ship or whatever, but this is the full-size one for the Yoda Count Dooku fight. And it was built inside a studio, inside a cave. So it was a real cave too. It wasn't green screen, most of the cave. It was all like artificial rock. They make it out of blow foam, like two-part foam, and then they sculpt it into this cool cave. But yeah, it took us months. They printed out all these drawings and we had to cut out like big ribs out of plywood, and then they plastered it, and then they sanded the plaster back until they had a mold, and then they put a fiberglass jacket mold on it and pulled that off as the main body of the ship, and then it goes to the scenic painters and things, and we're building all the landing gear and things. That took most of the time, is all the struts, and it's surprising how long it takes to do stuff like that. And then I built the execution cart too. That's my next job, actually. The one that they take into the arena. Yeah.
I didn't really build that.
Yeah.
That's pretty impressive.
Yeah. Wow. How long does it take to build something like that?
I think it took us about 3 months in construction, and then another probably 2 weeks for the scenic artist to paint it properly, like do all the metal, fake metal finishes.
Is it very hard to watch it like get destroyed on set or anything like that? Are you like, oh, my baby?
Yeah, it is. My first jobs in the film industry, actually, it was really sad how much things get just trashed, like thousands of dollars worth of materials that they just trash it and throw it, because it's cheaper and quicker to just destroy it and give it away. Oh. It's a little sad.
Do you ever just like, I'll just take this whole thing?
Well, luckily on Survivor, we're in countries that they really need the building materials, and then we pull it all down and give it to them to use. But in Sydney or in Hollywood, they just trash it. It's pretty sad.
Okay, so Nalini, like your first day, like on set, what was it like? And like, did you have any experiences with the other actors or anything that were memorable? Like, did you make any very like lifelong friendships or anything like that?
Yeah, I mean, I definitely, there's a lot of anticipation on the first day on the set, but I mean, all the actors that I've worked with, I pretty much kept in touch. I mean, not so much the A-list actors, because they're a bit untouchable, but, Jesse and
Zach. Yeah,
our
C-grades
are... Yeah, our C-grades, we don't kind of mix in those circles. But, you know, Jesse, Zach, Shakti, played by Uli Shoshan, Mary Oyaya, who played Luminarian Dooley, Amy Allen, who played Ayla Secura, Michonne Bourrier, Sharon... last name. I was about to say Stone, but I realised that was not her name. But, you know, we actually, yes, quite a few of us have kept in touch. And because we do a lot of conventions together, there's a lot of, you know, mingling and, oh, yeah, you're in this episode, and lots of the older Star Wars actors as well.
Yeah.
Got to meet them and know them and keep in touch with them as well. So it's always good because it's a community of actors, you know, that we have this common movie that we're in, but it's not just one movie, it's six movies, you know, so it's been really quite an amazing experience. But I've made some lifelong friendships and I'm very grateful for them. But first day on set, you know, I arrived at 5 a.m, was in makeup for 6 hours and didn't know how long makeup was going to be, but it was amazing transforming from what I looked like to this character. And I remember on the first day on sets, they had this guy who was some well-known interviewee, I don't know who he was, he came up and goes, so what does it feel like to play your character? And I said, well, I don't know anything about my character. And he gave me this really strange look, but I thought, no one's told me anything about who I play, I don't have any clue. And so, I mean, that was literally what it was. We did not know what we were doing, who we were, until, you know, we started to do those fight scenes before, maybe we're a Jedi, and you know, we're part of Jedi Council scenes or in the scene, so there's a lot of sort of deciphering of, you know, who we were playing on set. But, you know, it was a magnificent experience, to say the least.
Yeah, that's awesome. So do you guys have, like, just party with all the Jedi, where you're like, yeah, let's have a lightsaber fight with, like, all of the Jedi and everything like that?
I don't think we quite did that. I mean, I don't think I did that on set. I was, like, too because it's very professional. You know, you've got George Lucas there.
Yeah.
So we didn't do that. We sat around, like, looking at everybody and maybe talking a bit and seeing, like, okay.
We get in trouble anyway because our makeup, if you've messed your makeup up or broken something, they'd be like,
it was
stop! They treat the actors.
It was intense. Yeah. I mean, I was wearing a cape, and my costume was so heavy, and because we had contacts on, it was so hard, and our eyes were getting red, and they had to constantly come over and put drops in our eyes, and then we had these two blaring like massive lights, and we're overheating, we're perspiring. I mean, it's not comfortable. You don't talk about those things when you talk about your experience, but That's literally what goes on set. Yeah. I mean, they're the things that no one talks about as an actor, is that you're uncomfortable, you're wearing things that are uncomfortable, you're literally not doing too much in between takes, you're just trying to sort of rest before you've got to get up and do it again. So that's sort of what the experience was like. But nevertheless, it was still fun.
I'm sure it was still fun. And you're already on set anyway, but like, what was your first day like filming? Like,
it was the same thing. I didn't know what to expect because I'd been trapped in the workshops the whole time. And then they call you in at 5 a.m. You're like, wow, I can't wait. And then you sit in the chair like this for like 4 hours. You know, what I mean? You start getting told not to move or smile, or you know. So it's pretty fun though. And as it usually got like, I don't think we ever sat next to each other, but orally and I were sitting together. You live in, you know, like the whole time you have this like 4 hour conversation at the side of your mouth. She cute? She usually looks cute with, I don't know, you can't tell with all the makeup on, because they kind of came in a few hours before me, you know. Like, it was a little luckier than you. I had about 3.5 hours, because it was like, the prosthetics are easier than the actual makeup.
Yeah. So, like, did you have a favorite scene? Like, the lightsaber, like, battle was, like, for me, is like, one of the most memorable scenes in Star Wars, just with like the droids and the chaos and like all these Jedi everywhere. Like, what was that like? And is that one of your favorite scenes? Do you have another scene you were in that was your favorite?
I like the fight scene because there was a lot of lead up to the fight scene. There wasn't a lot of fighting at the beginning. It was just a lot of talking, and there was this big lead up before they had the fight. So the battle arena was my favorite. And also because of the experience that led to that, because we knew how much we did on set in terms of fight scenes, you know, sequences that we had to learn. And just the fun that I had on set doing those lightsaber scenes was, you know, just something else. So I appreciated that scene a whole lot more, and would say that was probably my favorite part of the film.
Yeah, that's pretty fun for me too, but talking to you today reminded me that I played a Twix as well in... The musicians from the original Cantina, and then when we did the Cantina scene on episode 2, because I finished up my job as a carpenter, I was just looking for work, they just said, I'll come in this day and this day and this day and do extra work. So I always had the full-on Twix market popping around the Cantina. George Lucas's daughter next to me in the blue one, yeah. Okay. It was funny, she would chat the way. I didn't know who she was, but so it's kind of fun being in an alien bar. It's been my fun day. Yeah. I think I was so scared when I was doing the Jedi thing all the time of doing something wrong or messing it up or anything. Yeah.
Is it very awkward, just like, because how did you guys film like the scene? They did like a group shot and then individual. Is it like a little awkward just swinging the lights?
When you're doing an individual, they're going, oh yeah, make it cool, and you got like 100 other people staring at you.
Yeah, exactly.
Including crew that all knew me and like were teasing me a little bit because they knew me as a set guy, you know, and they go, look at you, acting now, blah, 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 and I'm like, oh. And then I got these gloves on, you didn't have either, like, the alien fingers, and then you close around the lightsaber, and all of a sudden your fingers would, like, and you're like, that doesn't look right, that looks kind of wrong, and your horns are, like, doing these ones, because they're not actually stuck on your skull, and you're picking up my brother's tentacles everywhere, because they're, like, coming up, and she's right, and I was like, so, yeah, it was a little nerve-wracking, but it was fun.
Are the lightsabers very heavy, like on set, or...?
No, they're like a broom handle, pretty much, painted green, and then they cast a, just a basic, really basic lightsaber handle, and they paint it silver, which is coming off on everyone's hands because it's so hot.
Are they metal?
No, the ones that we all use, pretty much not. The actual ones, the hero ones that the main... actors, the A-list actors, they all had beautiful ones that the guys handmade. Took some guys like 2 or 3 months to build one perfectly. It's all like little details and lights and all that stuff.
I think they got to keep them. I think Mace Windu, Samuel Jackson.
That's what I heard. I heard he insisted that he get purple too. Like the.
Oh, did he?
Did he have something carved into his lightsaber?
I think that is true. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
From another movie, right?
Yeah, because someone said that, and I.
BASMF. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. Wow.
Come and see us later if you.
Speaking of the lightsabers, like, how do they like, how many they make the lightsabers on set? Like, how do they make, like, we want to know about lightsabers. Like, how do they make lightsabers on set? Is it a very big room just for lightsabers, or?
There's a construction shop I was working in, and there's a props department where all the model makers and props makers work. and there's probably like 50 guys in there, and they've got milling machines and like lathes and everything you'd imagine you'd ever want to cast components and little things to make everything you want. But then the designer, the head designers, send down drawings to the workshop, to the art directors. The art director then passes it on to the head model maker guy, who is actually from England. And then he passes it on to certain projects, to certain groups, and they'll work together to build exactly what the picture is. Pretty talented guys. So these guys that do what they're like jewelers, you know, they like can make anything. Like, it's pretty amazing.
Did either of you have like a favorite part of your costume that you wish you could have kept? Did you have a part of your costume that you absolutely hated and you were like, I can't wait to get this off right now?
I don't know if there was, I mean, the cape was quite heavy.
Yeah.
It kind of was hurting, but I mean, there was nothing.
It was gorgeous.
Really, yeah.
Though,
really. So yeah, it's quite gorgeous, but I don't think there was any specific part of the costume that I liked. I mean, I did like the cape, but I liked all of it. I mean, you know, you can't really like one, not the other, because it all made up, you know, the outfit of the character. But no, I liked all of it.
Yeah, no, because when you first see Barriss in that scene with Padme, it's like the second scene in the movie. It's like, because we hadn't really seen any, like, women Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
Like, up until that point, like, you know, that much. So, you know, like, you just see her standing there and you're like, oh. Her presence is just like so, like, oh my goodness, who is this beautiful woman standing there? But it's like the costume just like gorgeous. It worked out so
definitely.
Well.
Thank you.
Did you?
Probably the contacts, though, it's starting to get pretty irritating at the end of the day because they weren't the highest quality, I don't think, and they were like pretty scratchy. So after filming all day in the heat, and the, you know, they started to get pretty itchy. But that's the only thing. Everything else is pretty comfortable. Like, if you go for two fittings, you're getting a, you know, custom Jedi outfit that fits perfectly, and the boots are all comfy, and it's pretty good.
Everything else was good. So when the movie premiered, where did you guys watch the movie? What did you think? Were you very excited to see yourself on screen? What was that like for you?
We didn't really know how much of our scenes would be on the screen, so I think it was really a lot of anticipation to say, oh, are we going to be in this scene, or are we going to not be in this scene? And so, you know, that was exciting, but I watched it before the main premiere in Sydney, and I watched it, I think it was like a week of filming, a week of showings, and I told this to the group yesterday, I watched it with Will Smith and his family, so he was in that group, and I think there was some other celebrities in that, you know, in the theatre at the time, but I mean, there's a lot of buzz and excitement, you know, because it's Star Wars, and there's a lot of anticipation, and I was sitting with Mary Oyaya, who played Illuminara and Julie for the movie, and we were like, oh, that's where you are. And, you know, it was kind of like that. It was very exciting. Was like, oh, I just saw you. Oh, and it was kind of like that, you know, the very few limited scenes that we're in. But we were kind of like, oh, what happened to all these fight scenes, you know, at the end of it?
True.
Like, I busted my guts to get that right, and, you know. After the sheer humiliation of not being able to do that at the beginning, you know, in the onset, and then learning it, and then... You know, but yeah, it was fun, and we're just glad that we had some presence, you know, on screen at the end of the day, and then we just got to film, so
So they cut a lot out. You film a lot that doesn't make it. It's part of the fun, though.
Yeah,
I would totally sit through a 10-hour Star Wars movie, as I'm sure most of the people in this room would. And did you see yourself like on screen during the? Battle scene, were you very excited when you saw yourself?
You have to watch pretty quickly to see.
You do. You should have gotten more screen time.
Yeah, a lot of people tend to say, I saw Zach, I didn't see you.
I was there.
That's good. It's pretty exciting.
Yeah. So, like, outside of the movie, we got to talk, Nalini, we got to talk about Barriss. Mm-hmm. So, you watched The Clone Wars?
Yes. Well, I've watched a few scenes. I can't say I've watched it the entire six seasons. I don't have as much time as I have, but I've watched a few of the different scenes, especially after I was shocked to hear of her, I want to say demise, because showing the dark side is demise as far as I'm concerned, but I remember seeing that fight scene that she had, and I thought, go, Barriss, go! Although she had turned to the dark side, I had really enjoyed seeing her kick someone's butt,
because
that's what she does. And but that's not what you're gonna ask me. You're gonna ask me something about that.
Well, I was gonna ask you about that too. Like, what did you think about that? And I also wanted to ask you, like, not that it was you, and I know Meredith Salinger plays her on The Clone Wars, but what was it like? Because it freaked me out just watching the scene with Barriss when they had, I forget what they're called, The brain worms.
Oh,
where, like, it came out of her mouth at Ahsoka, and I was like, ooh! Like, did that kind of freak you out, seeing a character based on you having it come out or anything?
No, I think I was just really impressed that she had the ability to heal. Mm-hmm. I was very impressed with Barriss's ability to do that, so... No, I didn't think so. And I don't think the character was like that either. I don't think Barriss was shocked by anything that happened like that.
Yeah, she's
I think
pretty
she
calm.
Just had... Yeah, she's a pretty calm, you know, controlled, you know, very strong, resilient Jedi. So, yeah, I don't think that was a shock. And I find that stuff, you know, fascinating because I like horror films. So, you know, you see a lot more than that. You know, and it was animated, so it was okay for me to watch.
When Barriss turned traitor, did you, like, see her... Could you kind of see her point of view at all when she was telling everyone why she did it?
Yeah, I think she did it because she had lost faith, and she really didn't believe that they were doing what they were meant to do. So she was standing up for the truth. She was standing up and she was fighting for justice because, I mean, that's what Barriss does.
Mm-hmm.
So I understand her point of view, and I don't really think we can blame her. I personally don't think you can blame her for why she did what she did, personally. I think she was just doing... what a Jedi should really do. I mean, if someone's going to turn, you know, corrupt, then are you still following them simply because they say they're good, or are you going to stand up because they're corrupt and do the right thing?
Yeah.
So that was my point of view. And a lot of people agreed with me. A lot of fans said, I agree, and so forth. And some of them just couldn't get over the fact that she'd turned to the dark side.
Yeah.
And so
I was shocked. I cried. I was like, how could
a lot of people felt betrayed. I know. I got a lot of fans coming up going, I can't believe it.
How dare you?
I was very shocked. I was disappointed, actually, as an actor. I thought, well, that's not right. Character who was built up for 10 years to be this amazing healer and Jedi, and she goes from apprentice to a master, and she's so loyal to her, you know, her master, and she's just all these things. Mm-hmm. And for her to just turn like that, I think that if there was a gradual lead up to it, I would have understood, but I don't think there was, and so I think it was a real shock to a lot of people. But I think they also did it because a lot of people were talking about it, you know, and I think it kind of had this huge sort of excitement and attraction around the fact that she'd turned to the dark side and what's going to happen now, she's going to be in the Rebels, you know, and all that sort of stuff. So sometimes they do it more for an effect, you know, rather than just the fact that she's not really meant to be that way.
Yeah. Are you curious if she's going to show up in Ahsoka's... new book at all?
I don't know. I mean, I'd be keen to hear if she does. I'm sure a fan will probably tell me if she does. But honestly, I mean, who knows? She might end up in the Rebels. I mean, I don't know where they'll take the character.
I'm dying to know where her journey took her. You know, because they were taking her away in cuffs and everything. And I'm like, oh no! But what happens? You can't just leave us hanging.
Well, I do get occasional questions from fans going, "Did she die? Did she die?" I'm like, I honestly don't know, but I. Knowing Vara, she probably escaped. So I honestly don't know, and I'm excited to know that she's still alive.
All right. Yeah. And did you watch your character in the Clone Wars?
Yeah, I did.
Who voiced your character? Dee Bradley Baker?
I'm not sure, actually. I've never met him, that's for sure. I've never seen him come to a convention. Yeah.
I think it was nice at Clone Wars because it's like we got a glimpse into all the Jedi that we didn't get to know that much about, and it's like, you know, I think the Clone Wars are just as important as a movie. It's just kind of like round out the characters and everything, especially with like Luminar and Barriss.
Yeah, definitely.
As well.
Yeah, especially because they didn't get a lot of screen time and there wasn't much of a character development for those Jedi. So it's good to see that they got that in the anime.
Yeah.
Animated in Clone Wars.
Does anyone have any question for the two Jedi?
Were you guys Star Wars fans growing up or before you did the movie? Or
I was. My brother and I ran around the yard with torches strapped to you know, PVC tubes playing Jedi. So, I was a huge fan.
I watched repeats on TV.
Right.
And when I watched repeats as a child, I mean, I wasn't at the cinemas at the time that it all came out. I wasn't born. But I actually remember watching the Ewok Adventures. And really, as a child, I was very excited about that. And I was really fascinated with Darth Vader, actually, as a child. Because we didn't know who he was. It was just a Duke voice. And so I kind of really rooted for Darth Vader, you know, as a child. But yeah, that was my experience with Star Wars.
It's funny because the movies come out so much later back when I was a kid. in Australia. And, like, it wasn't like now where it's a day release, or sometimes Australia releases before, you'd be like, you'd start hearing about Star Wars in the paper and stuff, and it'd come out like 3 weeks later, or, you know, someone would tell you about a movie, and it just always take that long, because they'd have to ship the you know, the film to the theatre and all that kind of stuff. So it's kind of funny, but we loved them. Like, I'm a little older than Nalini.
What are your guys' favorite Star Wars? I'm going to make you pick. What's your favorite?
No, like, when people ask me, I'm like, I don't know. But I actually like episode 7. I have to admit, it was full of action, and yeah, I really did like episode 7. Yeah.
I think Empire for me, but I think that Rogue One is going to be my favorite.
Ooh.
That's going to be awesome, isn't it?
Did you do any set work on Rogue One? No,
it's all there. They filmed it all in England, this one.
Okay.
Yeah, a few of my friends actually that worked with me on Survivor worked on it.
Oh, really? Yeah. On the set or like on
Yeah,
on
props actually.
On
they
props,
did.
Yeah.
They make lightsabers and all that stuff. Yeah.
Can you tell us about a little bit of your work on Survivor?
Sure, if people are interested. Yeah.
Just to kind of know what you said Survivor, so yeah.
I've been working on Survivor for 16 years, and I just came back from Fiji. Fiji, where the wing is from. We filmed 2 seasons there. Went through a Category 5 cyclone, which is kind of exciting when we're there, batting down the hatches. I don't know. If anyone's got any questions they can ask, but it's pretty fun job.
Was there a big wrap-up party afterwards that you guys attended?
The Star Wars, yeah. Yeah, it was awesome.
Were you there at the party?
Yeah, I was there. Yeah. I'll tell
you a story, though. When we went into the party, I don't know if you were there at the time. I'd just gotten in. George Lucas is really short, but he's walking around with this really tall, like, bodyguard, like, really tall. And I think everyone was really scared to go and approach him because the bodyguard didn't look very friendly, and he was just walking around. And then I thought, you know what, I'm going to go up and say hello. So I went up and said, hey, George Lucas, thank you for letting us be in the movie. And then his bodyguard saying to my friend, does she know George Lucas? And I'm thinking, but hello, we worked with him on set. I thought it was really funny that he would ask that question after it was all the actors and crew and everybody that had been on set, and he was hosting his party. But
yeah, it was super strict to get in, I remember, because I worried about fans getting in it. Mm. So it's a cool party, though, I remember. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. A lot of fun.
Were there any like fun memories from the party or anything?
That was the memory that I remember the most. The fact that it was awkward because no one wanted to approach him. Then once I approached him, people went up to him, but his bodyguard just being really, you know, just, you know, George Lucas and, you know, trying to be like the ultimate bodyguard. And then it was just like, I don't know, I don't even think I remember most of it, to be honest.
It was a special night for me because it was the finale of the first season of Survivor, the night of the party, and so we got 54 million people watched or something. And then my brother and my best friend got the job on Survivor with me to come away straight after that to work with me, and then we went to the party, and it was just like a bit of a blur after that. it was a good night though.
It was like
9-10 months it was filming in Sydney, like not filming but in construction and everything, so it was like people's nearly a whole year of work, and so everyone got invited. It was all the props guys, like nearly 1,000 people at that party. It was crazy.
Wow. You guys get to travel a lot of places for the conventions. Do you guys have any like favorite places that you've been, or any like fun memories at conventions?
I'd have to say Japan.
Yeah.
When me, Jesse, Zach, and Christian Simpson, all from Star Wars, went. I'd probably say it was the best time we had.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Went to Nagoya and Tokyo and did like, what was it, 7-10 day?
Yeah, we went on to Osaka, so we were there after you left.
Oh yeah, you continued on, didn't you? Yeah. But it was an amazing trip.
Yeah, it was super cool.
Yeah, Japan's amazing. If you haven't been to Japan, go and visit
Japan.
It's
fun, yeah. Yeah, it's super fun.
Any questions?
Have you guys dressed up as your characters since the Star Wars movie in any way?
I have.